I consider it a great, not just only a great pleasure, but a great privilege to stand here in the Allen Library and speak to a group of people who are obviously patriotic at heart, love their country, appreciate history, and now hopefully you'll appreciate what happened in World War II as well, because that's what I'll be talking about. In December of 1941, I was a senior at college in Wisconsin, and I was preparing to graduate right after the first of the year, and then I was thinking of going on to post-grad work. I wanted to be an engineer. But on December 7th, the Japanese had other ideas. When they bombed Pearl Harbor, we found ourselves quickly at war on two fronts. In Europe, against the Germans and the Italians, in the Pacific against the Japanese. So all my plans of continuing education or anything else that I might have done went out the window. We were at war, and that's all that mattered. And I remember those days, and there's some here that will recall those from maybe early on in your years, that when we declared war, the country rose up as one, united in our effort to overcome the obstacles that we were facing around the world from two mighty military powers that had been preparing for war, while for us, we were a peace-loving nation. And actually in 1940, just before the war, we had an army of only 240,000 people. 240,000. Yet war clouds were gathering in Europe and in the Pacific. The Congress passed the Selective Service Act, and the draft began right after that, 1940. And before it was all over, we had drafted 16 million men, drafted or volunteered and enlisted, 16 million men in the services, starting practically from scratch. I was in reserve officers training in Ripon College, Wisconsin, and my first inclination was to resign and join the forces. We were, after all, at war. Nothing else at the moment seemed to matter. The rest of the country got united back of the war effort. Women took the jobs of men who left the factories. The Congress passed a lot of bills that were that provided for rationing of scarce material, of gasoline, meat, and all the rest. In recruiting stations were busy with young men lining up to get in the service. The country was at war, and everybody participated. And that's reason, looking back on that experience, why we were so successful, why we were overcome two military powers around the world. And we came out of World War II as the strongest nation in the world, and we still are, and we haven't looked back since. That was the situation when I graduated. I was a second lieutenant, and I had orders the same day. Report to Fort Knox, Kentucky for active duty in 8 days. Well, make a long story short, I knocked around the states in training camps and one thing or the other while the war had started, and I was getting antsy to do my part, and that is to come to grips with the enemy. And I asked a reviewing board that reviewed me as to what I wanted to do in the Army, and I asked one question. What is the quickest way that I could get into combat? And the board said, unhesitatingly, join the paratroopers, and you'll be in combat. Well, paratroopers was a new branch of service. We'd never had paratroopers before. We just started the school. It hadn't been perfected yet. It was still a risky business. But in any event, it had a certain challenge to it. For the young and the strong-hearted and others who wanted to get on with the business at hand. I went through parachute school, and they were correct that shortly after I graduated, I was shipped off to Africa. From there, I came up through Italy and fought through Italy in the mountains of Italy. I fought at Anzio and the Anzio beachhead, was wounded twice there, eventually hospitalized. but rejoined the unit, jumped in Holland, 62 days in the Battle of the Bulge, the Rhine River, and all the rest. And I look back on that career, and there are certain events that stand out. And I had for a long time thought about writing my experience, but several things promptly, I guess, motivated me to get on with telling my story. And that is that my whole experience in World War II was as a platoon leader. A platoon leader. Through all the campaigns that I mentioned, the Italian campaign and all the way through Europe. And then in January 1946, we returned to the United States in the Victory Parade in New York. I was with the same company the whole time. And I had a story to tell about the war in a way that I felt that the macro historians did not write about the war. Macro historians write about the big picture, about the grand alliances, the political aspects, the movement of troops and armies, casualties in the tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands. But in reality, wars are fought in squads and platoons by mostly young men, many still teenagers, led by non-commissioned officers and by junior officers. They bore the brunt of battle, they had the most casualties, they faced the enemy but prevailed. And in the process, several types of friendships emerged. One is that I refer to that a relationship between us that was stronger than brothers. We looked to each other. We fought with each other. They weren't numbers as was carried by the upper echelons when they talked about battles. They were our buddies, some mother or son. So we had that feeling about it. The other thing is when I first came home from service, I saw a number of movies, and they tended to glamorize movies. And that disturbed me because war is the most brutal form of human endeavor. And anyone who chooses to glamorize war in any way, I think, dishonors the memory of the young men and women who fought and died to preserve those values we hold dear. So I want to really tell the story of what it was to be a combat soldier for 2.5 years, and not to debunk any particular theory, but I felt that story had not been told. And the other one is that when I talk about being a platoon leader, let me just digress for a minute, for those of you who are familiar with our military structure, and tell you how our chain of command operates from top to bottom. As you know, the commander-in-chief is the president. He's the constitutional head of the military forces. He's the commander-in-chief. Below him are the joint chiefs of staffs, army commanders, corps commanders, division commanders, regimental commanders, battalion commanders, company commanders. Then all of a sudden, you come to platoons and squads, and they're platoon leaders and squad leaders. Platoon leaders in squads and platoons lead from the front. They lead in battle. Commanders command from the rear. They do their job. And I've never taken issue with that ever, and I don't now. But their job was different, to command, to make sure we had what we needed. But the leadership is at the lowest level, and that's where wars are fought. And that hasn't changed even today, as I followed the war in Afghanistan, Iraq. And incidentally, I've been to Afghanistan 3 times to visit, twice with 82nd Airborne Division and once with 101st by invitation. And as Tom indicated, the first time I went, and I was up in the Pakistani border in a very remote outpost, the men were going on patrol that day along the Pakistani border looking for bad guys or to interdict the access routes of the Taliban and Al-Qaeda into Afghanistan. They took me along with them, put body armor on me, gave me an M4 carbine, sat me in the Humvee, put earphones on, and we took off. I was gone all day. Now, that's a strange story for, at the time, I was 90 years old. Incidentally, I have a website, let me digress again, and I write about that experience. And the one thing I focus on, and I don't want to get too far into it, but it's a point of interest in any case. I told the soldiers out there, first of all, I thank them for the job they're doing for us. I think we have great troops. I think young men and women in service today are tremendous. They're in a tough environment, they're away from their families. It's a difficult situation. I tell them I was in World War II, and they refer to us as the greatest generation. Well, I said, I'm not in the business of comparing one generation against another, but I will say this, and that is, we may not have been the greatest generation, but those of us who took the fight to the enemy were the best of that generation, just as you today are the best of your generation. And every previous generation that has answered the call when our country was in trouble were the best of the generation. And I tell them that, and I mean it. Well, in any case, I have a number of other things, and one of my, the last point was, I talk to the soldiers about leadership. Leadership is a big thing, not just in the military. It's absolutely essential in the military, but through corporate structure, through sports. You hear about the quarterback being the leader, and leader is used a lot, the leader of the school board, the leader of the community, and they all have some kind of a role. But when I talked to the troops, and I made this speech four times at the request of commanders to our troops over there, I talked to them about leadership in mortal combat. Leadership in mortal combat in the military. Leadership in the face of deadly enemy fire. Because the outcome of the battle is going to be determined on the battlefield, at what happens on the battlefield, not what happens back in Washington or anywhere else. That may be important, but the outcome of the battle is going to be on that battlefield. And who wins or loses is going to have an effect on the role of history, on the whole course of history. For example, if the Russians would have succeeded at Stalingrad, or the Germans, and Russia would have capitulated, I'm sure that would have changed the whole course of the war. And history today would be different. The same thing on D-Day. If the Germans and the West Wall would have turned us back and were not able to penetrate it or got into Europe, things would be different again today. So the battles and decision are fought on the battlefield by squads and platoons and by young men. And I want to use one example. I could use a half a dozen or more, but I want to use one example of what I talk about, leadership in mortal combat in the face of deadly enemy fire. And it was in a campaign in Holland on September 17th, 1944. We jumped in Holland with three airborne divisions. The 101st Airborne Division, which was in the lower part of Holland. Above them was the 82nd, the division that I was in, and above us was the British 1st Parachute Division at Arnhem. And the plan was that the airborne troops would jump and would seize this corridor through Holland, control all the access, all the bridges, and there are a lot of them in Holland, control the bridges. In the meantime, Montgomery's 2nd Army, led by the 30th Armored Corps, would move through this corridor, get up to Arnhem rapidly, turn the corner and go east and be in Germany and in Berlin, as Montgomery proudly said, by Christmas time. This was September. That was the plan. We left Holland. We left England in a vast armada of ships. In the daylight jump, And we jumped up near Nijmegen. That was where I jumped. And our initial mission was to control that whole area. There was one main bridge over what's known as the Maas River. For those of you who are familiar with the geography of Holland, the Maas River. And it was our mission to capture that bridge and control it. And above that, another 10 miles at Nijmegen, were two bridges. The main highway bridge and a railroad bridge. That we would capture Nijmegen and control the bridges. And when the British came through with their tanks, they would hastily get up to Arnhem, and they would then engage the German forces there, and the mission would succeed. That was the plan. Well, things went well the first couple of days. We did capture the bridge over the Wall River, or the Maas River, and we cleared the area on Nijmegen. We were still fighting for the city of Nijmegen. When I say we, that was the 82nd Airborne Division. That was our mission, the Nijmegen area. We had one regiment in the city that was trying to clear the approaches to the bridges. But the British tanks then caught up with us or met up with us, but they would not attempt to cross the Wall River unless they were certain that the Wall River was secure, that we secured both sides. At this point, we hadn't secured either side. And this was the second day after we jumped. We jumped on the 17th, and the 18th and 19th, we were still fighting to do that. In the meantime, the British 1st Parachute Division that had jumped in Arnhem, overlooking the advice and the intelligence from the Dutch underground, jumped in an area where there were two German panzer divisions practically on top of them. And in short order, they came under direct fire. They were getting wiped out. They were just hanging on by their fingers. They had a battalion trying to hold one of the bridges up there, but they weren't going to be able to hold up much longer. So something had to be done, and done right away. British tanks had to get up there and relieve them. The decision was made that we will cross the Wall River downstream from the bridges. We'll cross the river and then swing around and come back and capture the north end of the bridges. Well, we had felt at first when we heard that this mission was coming up that it was dark, so that we had the advantage of secrecy and cover at night. But this situation was so urgent at Arnhem that they had to get on with it right away. The British says, no, we can't wait. We have to control the bridges. So General Gavin, who was my commanding officer, made the decision, okay, we'll cross the river in daytime, in daylight, and we'll swing around back and just as quickly as we can and control the bridges so the tanks can cross. Okay, that was the plan. Now, the problem was we were an airborne division. We were an amphibious. I had kids in my company that had never been in a boat, let alone know how to run one. And we had no idea what kind of boats anybody had. That was an armored division. They weren't amphibious. But the decision was made we were going to do it. Well, it so happened that the 30th Corps, British 30th Corps, had 26 boats somewhere back in their column, were spread out for miles. And they would get that up there, and these would be the boats we'd use. Well, then it decided, it got 26 boats. We didn't know what kind of boats they were. We didn't know how they were going to be propelled. We knew nothing. I mean, that wasn't our repertoire. We were paratroopers. We were trained to jump behind enemy lines, not assault rivers, you know. But anyway, that was the mission. That's what it called for. And it so happened that the battalion that was chosen was mine. And then it was decided that it only boats enough for two companies of men, maybe a little over 200 men, and one of the two companies was chosen was mine. So I drew three lucky numbers, you could say. Anyway, that was the plan. We moved out of our bivouac area. We cleared out the area where we were at, and we came into Nijmegen and had a fight through Nijmegen, and then went downstream from the bridges. And we took cover behind a big dike. And those of you who are familiar with Holland know there are a lot of rivers. And they have dikes all over. Holland mostly is at sea level. They got big dikes. And this dike, particular dike that we went for, was 15 feet high on a slope. It could hold vehicular traffic, but it was also large enough to conceal us. So we moved out, fought through Nijmegen, and then took positions behind this dike. That was the setting. Now, we still didn't know what kind of boats we had. And in the Army, those of you are in the service, and I guess in other avenues of venture, if you don't have hard facts, rumors take over. And then everybody starts speculating. Well, I guess when it comes to rumors, they kind of characterize the person who's spreading it. He's either a pessimist or an optimist. Most guys said, oh, geez, we're never going to make it across this river. And other guys say, yeah, it'll be no problem at all. And other guys would say, yeah, well, you know, you heard of these Higgins boats? They're fast. And we'll get across that river in no time. And, oh, yeah, oh, sure. We didn't know what kind of boats we had. Nobody told us at all. But we were waiting for them. We were going to jump off at 9 o'clock in the morning, but the boats hadn't arrived. That gave further rise to speculation. What kind of boats are these? You know, how are we going to do it? In the meantime, we had taken up positions, defilade, that is, concealed positions, behind this big, long dike on our side of the river. And we kind of huddled up, waiting for the boats to come. Well, we'd get together. Guys, you'd get together, little groups. And while this was on, British Lancasters flew overhead and bombed the other side of the river where we were going to have to cross. And I looked up from my position, and I looked up, and that sky was black with an aircraft. It was so black, it's so thick, I wrote in my book, you could have walked on it. Anyway, that was our first sign that the Germans were over there in force, and they had a lot of firepower on their side. So that gave us some pause. Then in one of our other battalions in 82nd, they sent a patrol out on our side of the dike between us and the river, sent a patrol to clear it out, make sure there weren't mines, and that we'd be able to charge over and get down to the river. Well, the platoon leader who led that, a fellow by the name of Vishnuski, is a good friend of mine. We'd gone to parachute school together, and we'd fought all through Italy and everything. Well, when they got out in front of us and were down along, the Germans on the other side opened fire on him. He got killed. Several of his men were wounded. And we heard that. We knew that was the case. So that had us pretty concerned that there was substantial forces on the other side. Well, finally, the boat showed up. We thought we'd leave at 9. It was postponed until 10 and 12. And finally, about 1 o'clock, here comes these British trucks with our boats. Here are these young men, most of them just out of school, that had never known any violence in their life from happy, loving families, find themselves in this kind of a situation. When we saw the boats, we figured there's no way. The chaplain, who was with us on this, asked, how are we going to get these things across the river? There weren't any motors, there weren't anything. And the British said, you see that pile of paddles? Get over there and get some paddles. In my boat, there were 13 of us paratroopers and two engineers from one of our engineer companies. Their job was to accompany us over and bring the boats back for the second wave to get the rest of the battalion. He said, there's your paddles. Well, at that point, and before we jumped off and we're putting the boats together, we honestly felt that we couldn't make it. Not that we wouldn't try. Nobody questioned the orders. It had to be done, and it happened to be our turn. But whether or not we would be able to cross a river in some places as wide as the Mississippi with a swift current with those boats that were 15 foot long, they were collapsible. You pulled them up with staves, it was canvas, no armor, no protection, no nothing. None of us wore any life preservers to cross this river. It was an urgent situation. The British were being wiped out at Arnhem. If we didn't get there and relieve them, the mission would fail. It was that simple. So something had to be done, and had to be done. So when we realized that, guys sitting there talking with each other, if they had a watch, they'd take it off. They'd look around behind, who was happening behind them in the support troops. Hey, I got something for you. Give him his watch. And say, where I'm going, I won't need this. Anybody who had any valuables was giving them away. Guys were in little small groups talking about, you know, if they should happen to make it. I was with my buddy, and we said to each other, look, if either of us ever make it out of here, go and see my mother, tell her what happened. Okay. While we're doing that, a lieutenant from I Company, the other company, I was in H, and the other company that you saw went across this river, came up, and he came up to see me. He was another friend of mine. I had gone to parachute school with him, fought all through with him in the mountains of Italy and everywhere else. And he came up and he said to me, Maggie, he said, you know, I don't think I'm going to make it today. He said, I have this feeling that I'm not going to make it. Well, I looked at the guy and he was shaking. He was visibly upset and even discolored a little bit. He had a premonition. And all through the war, you know, we talk about divine signals of one kind or the other. And I never really accepted that carte blanche. I said it could be, but here was a guy. It was a gallant soldier. He'd faced fire and courageously, and all of a sudden, he was just breaking down. And I said, Pappy, you know, every time we have a mission, you know we're going to lose half of our men at least. That was always the case. In Anzio in the mountains of Italy, we turned over the personnel of my company 10 times during the war. We know that there'd be casualties, but that was our lot. This was a war. And that's the way it is in war. That's the brutality of it. You know this is going to happen, that you're going to lose men. But I said, Pappy, I don't mean you're going to get a day. You'll be okay. You'll be fine. Well, anyway, he got an I Company, and he charged across, and then we got on the other side. And let me just interject here and bend the clock ahead a little bit. 2 years ago, my wife and I were in Holland for a particular observance, and we went to a cemetery in Holland called Margraten, and there American soldiers are buried, beautifully kept. All white crosses and stars of David all over, a vast number of them, and each one identified. In advance of my arrival there with the party I had with me, the people who operated the cemetery placed little flags around where guys who were in my company, in my battalion, were killed in Holland. And so I walked around, I had my wife with me, and we walked around, and all of a sudden, I walk up to a marker, a white marker, and it said on her, First Lieutenant Harry Busby, killed in action September 20th, 1944, I Company, 504th Parachute Regiment. There he was, Pappy Busby, I call him Pappy. There he was, and I hadn't seen him over 60 years. That he'd been laid to rest there. And I paused and I looked down for a minute. And it had a moving effect on me, because I always remembered Pappy. And what's more, I'd already written a book and told him, you know, that he about him having the premonition, but I never knew what happened when I wrote the book. And I told my wife, there but for the grace of God lie I. Because just woe been me, of course. And other people that came over looked at that, and when I tell them the story, And why I'm telling you this is because one of the reasons I wrote this book is Pappy Busby was carried as a number of the 700 or the 200,000 killed or so. He was a number, and he'll always be carried as a number. But to us, he was our buddy. He was with us. He fought with us and so on. He was more than a buddy. It's a relationship closer than brotherhood, as I'm telling you. And anyway, that was there. Getting back to the river, you saw that we charged over the dike carrying this boat. It was 18 inches from the gunwales to the bottom of the boat, and there was a sort of a plywood bottom. The rest was all canvas. We put them down in the water. We charged down there. We had a hell of a time. It was muddy. We got caught in the mud. We tried to get the boats in the water. It was mass hysteria. Really. How else could it be anything different? Think about that for a minute. You know the enemy is over there in great numbers. As it turned out, there were 200 of us paratroopers in the boat, along with the engineers and some of the battalion staff. In the first wave, the Germans had 1,000 men over there, dug in this dike that you saw we charged with machine guns. Behind them was a fort that was firing at us with everything they had, 20-millimeter flak wagons, or 20-millimeter guns, some 88s, mortars. And you saw the bridges, men were up in the bridges firing at us. There was 1,000 people firing at us, and we were trying to cross this swift river with a paddle. Well, as we started out, I was right next to the boat. You could hear the guy was saying, "Hail Mary." That was the battalion commander, Major Cook. They were pretty close to me. My boat was near him. And he started out saying, "Hail Mary, full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace." Repeated it. And then when the guys with the paddles and the rifle butts were trying to get the boat moving, he cut it down to "Hail Mary," like a coxswain would do with his crew when he pounded on the side of the shell to give a rhythm to the roars. That's what he was doing that for. "Hail Mary," to get these guys to all paddle together, because it was hard to hold the boat in any direction. There wasn't any steering mechanism, there wasn't any power, there wasn't anything. And also in the boat with him was Chaplain Keel. I talked to him he's now 92 years old. He's not well, but his mind is still alert. And I talked to him the other day. He was in the boat, and he was reciting, "Lord, thy will be done, Lord, thy will be done," repeatedly. And the battalion commander was, as you could hear in the strip, "Hail Mary, Hail Mary, Hail Mary." Well, I pause, and when you read my book, again, to get back to the reason I wrote a book, because historians don't write these things because they didn't experience them. How could you write about this unless you actually experienced it? And so I write about it, and also I note at that point, because it kind of registered in my mind, and it stuck with me somehow, and it found its way into my book when I wrote it. And the other side were 1,000 Germans spread out all over, covering this whole area, laying down fire on us. And I said, those Germans had to be praying to the same God. "Lord, give us strength to defeat our enemies. Lord, give us strength to defeat our enemies." They were in mortal combat just as we were. Well, about halfway through across the river, you could see men falling in the river. And I don't know if you noticed a boat that sank. Well, the boat that sank was half of my platoon. I lost half my men in that river. And I saw them. You know, they were just downstream from me a little bit. We could maneuver a boat, and if we did, we couldn't have done anything for them. They had their gear on, and they just sunk, and away they went. That's brutality. That's war. That's why I say it's the most brutal form of human endeavor. What other kind of endeavor would you find? What you just saw. Men trying to paddle across the river, and guys on the other side taking shots at them. Well, I lost half my platoon. And finally, we made it across. But when we got to the other side, if you noticed that the approach to the dike was anywhere from 500, 800 yards. And the Germans were dug in that whole area with machine guns. And they had them set up. It's what we call interlocking grazing fire. That is, the fire would come at about knee high and interlocking. It was flat ground, just as flat as the stage I'm on. So when they started opening a machine gun, there were bullets coming everywhere. Well, we couldn't stay down at the river's edge. We had no cover. There weren't any trees. There weren't anything. It was just flat country. The only thing you could do is charge in the face of that fire. Now, the original plan was that if we did make it across, that H Company would assemble in one area and I Company in another. H Company would then proceed as a unit to attack the main bridge, the highway bridge, and I Company the railroad bridge. But the German machine gun had scattered us. There wasn't any unit integrity. There weren't any units together. It was every man but for himself. What happened was that sergeants, non-commissioned officers and junior officers, start charging towards that dike, and as the men saw somebody heading there, they got in behind them. They didn't know if that was their sergeant or who it was. It didn't make any difference. The enemy was firing at us. We knew where they were. They were laying down this machine gun fire. Guys were dropping around all over. We could see the bridges. The river was here. The enemy was there. We knew what our job was, and it had to be led. We didn't reorganize. We didn't issue any more orders. We didn't ask Washington's advice or anybody else. We were there. But we were combat soldiers who had been experienced in combat, and it was always my creed in combat, when somebody's firing at you and your men in an attack, don't go backwards. Go in the direction of fire. That's where the enemy is. He's not going to be behind you. And that was pretty much the thing. So we charged forward, and we charged it toward this dike, firing from the hip, cussing and swearing, just running purely on adrenaline, and so on. I write in a book that we were half human and half savage. How could you ever been anything different? If you were in that boat and you were going through that and you guys are dropping all over, that's not a natural human experience. And I also look back on that and other things that I read in my book. I led a lot of patrols at night back at enemy lines. And when you do, you leave your own lines and you go through what we call no man's land to get behind the enemy's lines. When you get behind there, you have no communications with anyone because you have to practice sound and light discipline. If you any light or any noise, the enemy will pick you up and bring fire in on you. And I learned to be able to kind of detect my way at night. I had a sense of direction. I'd leave our lines, I'd come through no man's land, and all of a sudden be back at enemy lines in the, engaged in battle, but able to find my way back. I believe the Lord has in all of his creatures some degree of sensitivity, a sense of direction. A deer, as you know, its protection is its sound and the sense of danger, where it'll flee when it thinks it's in danger. I've always felt that I had a portion of that. The other thing I write in my book, and you'll read it, I say that during the Battle of the Bulge, this is the next big battle we were in, we were engaged in heavy combat. We killed a lot of enemy soldiers in the Battle of the Bulge, an awful lot of them. And I write in there and pause and reflect, just exactly as I felt. I said, my MOS, in the military, it means military occupational specialty, that defines the job you got, your MOS, was to kill Germans. That's all. Nothing more, nothing less. And I indicate that we were in for the duration of war. It's the only thing we had to do. Kill Germans and end the war. The Army never had such an MOS, but I write it, and that was my MOS, to kill Germans. And then later on, I write something that I'm not sure I feel, you know, would write it today, but I wrote the book The Way a Soldier Felt. Tell the story exactly the way it was, the unvarnished truth, everything. And that is that, you know, whatever your occupation is, if you do a good job and you do well and you're complimented and you get a medal or something, you take pride in doing your job well. Let's say you were in my platoon and your job was to kill Germans, and you killed a lot of them. How would you feel? We felt great. I used to have to censor the mail of the men in my platoon. That was a requirement over there. Men would write home. Somebody had to censor it, make sure something in their value wouldn't fall in enemy hands. And every time we had a successful engagement, the guys who made it back would write and say, we really, you know, did this and we did that. And they were jubilant about it. And I pause and I reflect even now. How can anybody, any human being, a soldier, whoever he is, take satisfaction and be happy about killing a fellow man? How could that be? It's contrary to everything we ever brought up with or learned. But we did take joy in it because that was our job and we were doing it well. Well, we managed to get up to the dike, and I got there and I had my platoon sergeant with me, Sergeant Hirsch. And he'd been shot in the boat. He was with me. A number of the guys were shot in the boat. The bullet went through his, right above his wrist, and he was bleeding. So I had tied to my boots a first aid packet. I opened it up, and that's a bandage. I was bandaging it up. And the guys that were now coming, making it to the dike, were getting there, were starting to come to the dike, and the Germans pulled their machine guns and moved back, probably another phase line, expecting that we'd regroup and they'd be waiting for us. While I was doing that and I was bandaging up this Sergeant Hirsch's wrist, to my right was a sergeant. His name was White. He was in I Company. He was killed later in the war. In fact, he was killed later in Holland. He got up there and he was a squad leader, and he got up, jumped up, ran up top of that dike and looked down and he said, there go those SLBs. He says, men, after them, after them! They're yelling, screaming. And the guys, they came, they charged out. And the Germans were heading back, take up a defensive position between us and the bridges. Their job was to defend the bridges. I saw Hirsch, and I said, no sense us waiting, let's go. So I charged over the top with Sergeant Hirsch, and we headed for Fort Hof von Holland, which had been raining all this heavy fire on us. And I felt, if we don't silence those guys, nobody will get across the river, ever. Everybody went in the direction they had to go. They had to go either in the direction where the enemy were firing at us to eliminate them or to get to the bridges. That was our mission. And we weren't in squads. We weren't in platoons. We weren't organized at all, except that we were combat soldiers and we were being led by non-commissioned officers who were leading in the face of enemy fire. And I call that the highest form of leadership. That determines the outcome of the battle, who wins or who loses. Changes the course of history, right there, right there. I can go back into history and point out other cases. Oh, you could say, well, you know, Eisenhower made the decision that we're gonna go to Normandy. Well, that's great, that's a command function. That's all right, that was his part. But that didn't determine the outcome of the battle. It was under mortal fire, charging in a machine gun battle, swearing vengeance, knowing what your objective was, and not to be deterred. Well, I write about all that in my book in detail, and I try to stress the human point because the young men and women who are in service today, they're no different than we are. I mean, they have their feelings, they believe certain things, they look to each other in this environment, and it's tough. Now, the rest of the story is that Once we pushed the Germans off of there, and we silenced the fort, a few men with me and others, we silenced that fort, and then everybody headed for the bridges. By 7 o'clock that night, we controlled both bridges. And in one of the bridges, the railroad bridge, an officer in my company, Lieutenant Sims, and some men headed for that bridge. And they took up a position there and put a machine gun on this end of it. And the other side, there were Germans on that end of the bridge, decided they wanted to come over to our side, not knowing that we were there. And our guys waited till they got in the middle of the bridge and opened fire on them. According to Sims, they laid about 200 men lower in the water. Now imagine that. You're crossing a bridge and somebody's got a machine gun, he's firing at you. Where else but in this kind of a situation could you ever even dream up a scenario like that? Well, we pushed on. We overcome resistance, and I read about that in some detail. And finally, we get to the bridges. We got them. We're there. Those of us that made it across. We get word across to the British. Come on, guys. We got the bridges. It's safe. Come on. Well, a short while later, three British tanks start coming. They cross the bridge, the railroad bridge where we were at. We'd set up perimeter defense on the other end to protect it from a counterattack. Three British tanks come across, push across the bridge, go down a little bit. Now, Arnhem was only 9 miles away. That's where the British 1st Parachute Division was getting wiped out. So now they come through, but instead of pushing through, they stopped. And then one tank that was near me, tanker, got out, stretched a little bit, got down the road and reached over the side of the tank and pulled on a tea kettle, got out a little burner, started up, and started making tea. I said, "Matey," I said, get going. I said, "Your guys are up there, they're being wiped out." He looked at me and he said, "Matey," he said, "I have my orders." And his orders were, cross the bridge and wait until further orders, which would come from higher command. Now, British soldiers, I don't demean British soldiers, they fought well. But British were, as the army, and those of you who know history from Norman and everyone else, they were cautious and deliberate, and they didn't move until the stars were all just right and everything. But they were never great, in my judgment, at seizing a moment, taking advantage of an opportunity. They had to wait. They didn't move out then. Didn't move out that night. When they did move out the next day, it was too late. The unit up there had been all but wiped out. And that night, they were able to cross the river up there and get across and work their way back. Not a 10,000 British paratroopers up there. Get it back. We didn't capture Arnhem. That was a big bridge too far. The mission failed. Why did it fail? We had captured the bridges. The road was clear. Sure, they were going to run in German tanks. Of course, all about. But they weren't quite ready to do it. So it failed. We spent another... Well, I think I spent 58 days in Holland before we were relieved. But I tell this to the soldiers, that you know your job and you know your mission, and don't let anything deter you from your mission. And in a case of this kind, when something's got to be done, do it. And that is, to me, what I call leadership. The highest form of leadership, because nothing could be more demanding, require more courage, require more everything, audacity, if you will, than that. And by the same token, it don't speak very well of leadership on the part of the British. And I'm going to tell you this kind of a side story. We were, at that time, under British control. They were controlling the operation, and given the orders. And we were getting British rations. And every ration we had tea. And after I saw that Brit cooking tea, I never drank another cup of tea in my life. And my wife will tell you, I never drank another cup. And I can't understand why. Well, I took a lot of time to explain this to you because I want you to have an idea of what I had in mind when I was, what I wanted to say when I was writing a book, because what I've told you and what you'll read in my book is history, but not the way that the big history books are written. That isn't to say that history books aren't well written. They are, and it's important, and it serves a purpose. But if you're interested really in the men who did the fighting, what they believed in, how they felt, what they thought, what kind of guys they were, how they looked to each other, how they reacted in battle and all, then you gotta read the account of somebody who was there. And just one final word. And I talk about one particular situation and men under a difficult. The war was pretty much that way, but we prevailed. And I look back on the history of this great nation. And every time those values, as I said earlier, were threatened as a nation, we've always had young men and women who stepped forward to defend those principles. From the Revolutionary War on through every war, and now in the War on Terror. And if there's anything ever made this country great, it is because that's the kind of people that we are. This is the kind of a nation we are. The kind of people we are. What we believe in, what we stand for, what we're willing to fight for, what we're willing to die for, what we're willing to sacrifice for.